Well, Chief Justices, Deputy Chief Justice, Justices, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this, the first lecture of the DIFC Courts lecture series for 2014. And what a great honour it is to have both Chief Justice Michael Huang, Deputy Chief Justice Sir John Chadwick, and the Chief Justice or the Judge in Charge of the UK Commercial Court, Sir Jeremy Cooke. As well as the members of the legal profession in this room, the discussion is being broadcast around the world, certainly to the Middle East, North Africa, and the UK, thanks to Thomson Reuters and their technology. So smile if the camera happens to turn towards you. It is a great pleasure to welcome to the podium Chief Justice Michael Huang to start the ceremony today. And if you could turn off your telephones and put them on silent, it would be appreciated. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this event. We are delighted and honored to have Sir Jeremy Cooke, otherwise known as Justice Cooke, to come and lecture to us tonight. A very brief history of Justice Cooke's life and times. He was educated, he read law at St. Edmund Hall, Oxford, and went to the bar after first having served a period as a solicitor. And then after taking silk, he took silk in 1990, but he has been practicing out of number 7 King's Bench Walk, which is a well-known commercial set of chambers. And his fields of practice, or his practice areas, were energy, insurance, reinsurance, professional negligence, and shipping and maritime law. He was head of his chambers, and then eventually became a judge in 2001. In the commercial division of the Queen's Bench Division. He has served as the head of the commercial court, or the commercial division in London, for 2 years, over 2012 and 2013. And he has a particular connection with the DIFC because last January, I went to London and signed the MOG with the Commercial Court in London, and my counter-signatory was none other than Sir Jeremy Cooke. So we are very pleased to have him address us tonight, and his topic is going to be trends in the Commercial Court in London. Thank you.
Well, good evening. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be here. The Commercial Court in London is very international in character, and some of its advocates are foreign nationals who've been trained elsewhere before qualifying in the United Kingdom. And one such advocate was of United States origin. And on one occasion, he was not best pleased with one of my admirably succinct and forthright rulings which had gone against him. So he stood up and he looked me in the eye. What, he said, would be the consequence if I said that you were a demented, degenerate, stupid old fool? Remaining the picture of calm, but think I'd better nip this in the bud, I said to him, well, you could be reported to the Bar Disciplinary Board, you could be subject to disciplinary proceedings, suspended or disbarred, or alternatively, you could face an application for committal to prison for contempt of court. He looked at me again, and I could see he was thinking hard. And what, he said, would happen if I did not say that, but I just thought it? In those circumstances, I said, there would be nothing to be done. You can think exactly what you like. Then he said, let the record show that I think you are a degenerate, demented, stupid old fool. Well, be that as it may, I'm going to talk to you about three interrelated topics from the perspective of a commercial court judge in London. And the first is what I see as the dangerous trends in commercial litigation. The second is the changing trial process. And the third is the role of the judge in case management and costs management. So let me start by telling you about a trial that I presided over last summer. It was a large and unusual case and an extreme example of its kind, but nonetheless illustrates, I think, where commercial litigation may be heading in London and elsewhere. This trial ran from April 2013 to late July on a set timetable with witnesses confined to specific periods of time and cross-examination limited by reference to that time. The opening submissions from the two parties were of about 1,000 pages each. We had about 25 witnesses of fact and 12 expert witnesses. And the witness statements for the witnesses of fact were of inordinate length. And when I say inordinate, I mean 100 to 300 pages, something of that kind, and some of them two or three statements because they were supplementary statements responding to the other side. And all of those statements had been drafted for them by lawyers. They were highly nuanced, and they had reference throughout to a whole series of banking documents, recorded telephone conversations, Bloomberg chats, and the like. Witness statements and experts' reports ran together to thousands of pages, upon which they were then cross-examined. I then, at the end of this period of just over 3 and a bit months, asked for succinct closing submissions on the basis that I thought I'd heard enough. And the idea was that they'd produce these and then we'd have a couple of days running through the main points by way of oral submission. In the last week in July, I'd received written submissions running to 1,800 pages from each side plus appendices. The parties then told me that they didn't have time properly to respond to the written submissions orally. So I said to them, I'm going to start writing this judgment in August, like it or not. So if you've got anything you want to say about the credibility of witnesses, you better come and say it. So they came and they had their say over a day or so. After their summer holidays, while I had been busy writing the judgment, they decided that there was actually nothing further they needed to respond to from the other side, except in 5 pages dealing with points they hadn't thought of before. Three things stand out for me from that experience. The first is the sheer number of issues which arose and which were argued fully. I had a succession of what we call case management conferences, 4 or 5 over a period of 2 years before the trial, each of those case management conferences lasting 2 days and requiring a couple of days reading beforehand. Each day was a long day, not finishing till gone 6. The structure in the commercial court is that the parties prepare a list of issues to aid the court in the questions that it has to decide. When the list of issues at the third case management conference reached 46 pages, we decided there was little point in continuing. Not just because of the length of it, but because the parties couldn't then agree on what the other issues were that failed to be decided. And that will give you just an example, an illustration of the difficulty in managing the case. The second point that stands out is the volume of disclosure, particularly the e-disclosure, all the email documents and the like, which largely formed the subject matter of witness statements and expert evidence. If we'd had bundles of trial documents, hard copies, there would have been 150 of such for every advocate and for the judge in the court, of contemporary documents, never mind the witness statements or anything else. Instead of that, what we had was something which is becoming increasingly common now in London. The use of a computer system with all the contemporary documents on it. This operates with a presenter, and the presenter sits in front of the judge, and he operates the system on the instructions of counsel as to which document they want brought up on a screen for the benefit of the court and for the benefit of the witnesses. The witnesses also have hard copies, because I insisted on that, because otherwise the witness is not in a position to see the context of the page about which he or she is being cross-examined. But the object was to move more towards a paperless trial. In my judgment, a paperless trial is most unlikely in the end to eventuate, because I think it's very hard to do justice and be fair to witnesses without them having the opportunity to see the documents round about the particular paragraph or page that's being put up on the screen. We had at the same time LiveNote, a transcription service which brings up on another screen the evidence as it's actually being given, and many of us, including myself, had a third screen so that I was not dependent upon what was being shown by the presenter on the screen. I could myself flip from document to document again to see what else was going on that was of relevance. If I tell you that counsel all cross-examined from hard copies, I don't suppose you'd be surprised for a moment. Impossible, I think, to do it from a screen in reality. The overall effect was that when I came to write the judgment, I printed off, in fact, from the computer, the hard copy documents that I thought I needed in order to write the judgment. And I printed off about 6 or 7 lever arch files, in addition to which I had the witness statements and the experts' reports. So I finished with about 30 or 40 bundles instead of what would have been close to a couple of hundred had everything been in hard copy. Now that's an extreme case on any view. But the dangerous trends, I think, are these. First, the increase in the number of cases which we hear where the money at issue is so large that costs pale into insignificance. And the effect that this then has on the case and the way the litigation is conducted is, to my mind, appalling. The effect is that every point is argued, however good, bad, or indifferent. 3 times I said to the parties, I would like you to apply what I call the red face test. The red face test is this. Imagine, and it may be a figment of your imagination, but imagine you're addressing a judge who, in whom you have confidence, who you know is knowledgeable and is likely to get it right. Could you address that judge and put forward this argument without going red in the face, or at least thinking that you ought to go red in the face? And if you can't, don't run it, because your good points will be destroyed by your bad. 3 times I made that plea, which fell on deaf ears. Secondly, the increasing quantities of documents disclosed in this electronic age. Huge, huge numbers. Next, the increasing number of issues raised, the increasing volume and content of witness statements of the kind I've mentioned, the increasing use and complexity of expert reports with heavy appendices, and something I regard as less than satisfactory, but the increasing replacement of the oral tradition by written submissions and written statements and written material. I'll take those, if I may, briefly, one at a time. It's plain that some of these problems are quite unavoidable. It's unreal to look back to some golden age of litigation where trials were short, with only the most important points argued and limited documents. But each of those things that I've referred to gives rise, I think, to an increased risk of injustice, increased cost, and increased client dissatisfaction with the course of litigation. It simply gets out of hand. And what we like to think of as Rolls-Royce justice may be in danger of becoming a runaway juggernaut. Cases take on a life of their own. And one of my observations about life in the commercial court of late is that we have an increasing number of cases which, despite what we like to think of as efficient case management, take 3 months or more to try. Probably one or two every term, every legal term now. And the judgments almost inevitably suggest that the uninitiated view at the outset, before the trial began, would be correct. The case has simply run because of the amount of money in it and not because of the issues that actually were involved. The stake had increased by the costs, but the odds hadn't changed one iota. Despite the industrious and conscientious efforts of extremely able lawyers using great legal research and eloquence in an attempt to complicate and obfuscate the issues. You, I'm sure, have met with the problem of e-disclosure. It is probably the most expensive part of litigation. The amount of money that's spent now by lawyers in simply going through this process with the aid of search consultants, identifying ways to produce the right documents, and then reviewing those documents on all the hits to work out what has to be disclosed, it's gargantuan. And when I come to look at the costs at the end of a trial, that is almost invariably an enormous element in it. And one always asks the question, how much of this has really assisted in the process of justice? Well, of course, the problem is you don't know what's there till you look. And we'd all like to cut it back to what we would think of as practical levels. There's very rarely a smoking gun to be found in the other side's documents. But having said that, in the trial that I did here, there were 3 recorded telephone conversations which proved key in establishing the knowledge on the part of a particular agent at the relevant time. And those you would only discover by doing the full process. I think the proliferation of issues is also directly connected to the amounts of money involved, and I suspect also with the amount of materials disclosed, because ingenious lawyers, when they have lots of documents, can think of new arguments. And the initial point of dispute which gave rise to the litigation then gets lost in this sea of other points that are raised by ingenious lawyers. Lawyers' constructs take over. The length of witness statements, the style of witness statements, result, to my mind, in the obscuring of the real evidence. We have highly polished comment and argument dressed up as evidence, recitation of documents that the witness has never seen and couldn't possibly remember, and it drives judges to distraction. Often, the statement sets out no real recollection of the witness at all, but simply what the lawyer thinks he ought to be saying, because this is what the documents show. And of course, if the lawyer's construction is wrong of the documents, the witness is talking nonsense. I mentioned expert evidence. It's a hazard of modern litigation. Hired guns, I fear many of them are. I actually found 2 of the experts on one side to be, frankly, partisan when I came to write my judgment. And on talking to a judge who does a lot of landlord and tenant work, he said to me, "When have you ever found an expert who appears on behalf of a landlord who gives a lower valuation than that of the expert for the tenant?" This is true. And lastly, in this context, the subversion of the oral tradition. Skeletons. You have skeleton arguments here. I've seen them. The dry bones have been covered with sinew, with muscle, ligament, tendons, flesh, and even manicured fingernails, it seems to me. We have written tendentious statements instead of evidence in chief of an oral kind. We have these huge experts' reports. It's all meant to save time in court, which undoubtedly it does, but increases judicial time out of court. And it limits, in my mind, the opportunity for judges to assess the credibility of witnesses until they're immediately faced with cross-examination. The only circumstances in which it's common in London for people to give oral evidence in chief is where there's a case of fraud or an oral agreement or an oral meeting where things really matter as to what was said, and then you ask witnesses for their direct recollection. But by that time, they've been coached to such an extent that you wonder what you're hearing. And there's a real risk, I think, that the evidence is not only obscured, but when you come to closing submissions, which are in writing, it's hard to see the wood from the trees. The old business of question and answer sessions of the judge probing the advocates in closing is missing and is, to my mind, certainly unhelpful in the context of doing justice. So the second element I wanted to mention, which I can pass over fairly quickly, is this: the changing trial process. I've mentioned already things that have changed, certainly since I first began. When I first began at the commercial bar back in 1970-something, there were about five sets of commercial chambers, and there was one judge, essentially, who ran the commercial list. And all documents were read to him at the outset of a case, any document that anybody wanted to refer to. And the process was undoubtedly long-winded. Evidence was oral, and transcripts, if they were produced at all, came in on an overnight basis. And all authorities were given in a list to the usher with piles of books produced. No photocopies or anything of that kind. Now, much has changed, and we are undoubtedly a leaner and more efficient court for many of those changes. But the factors that I have just mentioned, to my mind, do not assist in the process. I don't think we've got the balance quite right now, particularly as regards the evidence of witnesses in chief, as regards the evidence of experts, and as so far as closing submissions are concerned. I think there's a lot to be said for having witness summaries rather than these huge statements that we get, and actually asking the witness to give his recollection in chief from the witness box. The other thing is to enforce a limit on the number of pages in a witness statement. To my surprise, I found that in the commercial court guide, we actually have a provision which requires the parties to ask permission to put in statements of more than a certain length. I'd forgotten it was there, and I'm quite sure nobody else is aware of the rule either. And then this other matter of matrix evidence. Do you have matrix evidence here in relation to construction of contracts? If you don't, you're very fortunate. It's something that Lord Hoffman is responsible for. But we're now requiring people to plead any matrix evidence they want to rely on, and then to agree it. Because in my experience, if there are any points that are relevance in construction, they can usually be reduced to one side of a piece of paper, instead of endless statements that give a background that helps nobody at all. And the last element I want to mention in this context is the possibility of a judge having the opportunity of being instructed by experts in a particular discipline. In the same way that counsel are in their own chambers, so the judge can have the experts, both sides in front of him, and ask the basic questions about the particular field in which they operate, with which he's unfamiliar, so that he understands, before the witnesses are ever cross-examined, exactly what the relevant principles are. It happens, but very rarely. There is provision for it. But I think it would be a real plus. And then lastly, I'd like to see a reversion to full oral closing submissions, where the judge can probe and ask the questions and test the submissions that are being made. That's part of the changing face of litigation, the trial process. And the last element in this that I want to refer to is alternative dispute resolution. I know you have it here. I've seen what goes on from the statistics and what I've been told. But in every order for directions that we give in the commercial court, we now make an order for alternative dispute resolution, whether it's mediation or negotiation. Over 90% of cases begun in the commercial court settle, many before, in fact, even the order for ADR takes effect. But my observation is this, that a noticeably greater proportion of the largest cases tend to fight for the reasons that I've given. Whereas I think 20 or 30 years ago, the larger cases tended to settle because there was much more to be said on either side and the parties were less sure of what the outcome might be. I turn then to the other element of electronic documents. I mentioned how this trial ran in front of me. Last summer we had, I think, 6 or 7 trials of varying lengths which took place in that way. Technology is improving all the time. I think it's the way of the future. There are various problems which are being overcome in relation to spreadsheets in particular and how you make notes that pass over one page to the next, but the enterprises that are dealing with this are very responsive to commercial pressure. And as those matters improve, I think this will become commonplace. You probably wouldn't know, but in the criminal context in the UK, the Crown Prosecution Service now in England is seeking to have all its trials handled by advocates with tablets, and all the disclosed documents are put in an electronic depository for the parties to access, thereby getting rid of paper. These are in small criminal trials. And so we find on the one hand small criminal trials, on the other hand large commercial trials. It seems to me it's not long before this will effectively take over in terms of the basic documentation for a trial. The cost of the exercise is considerable. I'm skeptical about how much it will in fact help on economy, but there's no doubt that in a very large case it saves a huge amount of photocopying and the practicality of having 20 or 30 people in court with 150 lever arch files each. I'm an old dog. I don't learn new tricks very easy. And I don't find doing everything on computer comes terribly easily to me. But as this new younger generation of judges comes through, so I guess they will find it easier than I do. Leading counsel didn't seem to manage entirely with computers either, cross-examining from hard copy documents. But life is changing all the time. Finally, I turn then to the question of the role of the judge. Case management and a new feature in England of costs management. The cost of any litigation appears simply to go up and up, in part because of the trends and changes to which I've referred. But justice does become increasingly expensive and hazardous in relation to the risk involved with smaller claims in particular. And costs are a perpetual issue in the pursuit of justice, particularly if you've got parties of unequal financial strength. And I've certainly seen many cases where what's going on in reality is a war of attrition between one set of lawyers and another. Costs are the weapon. The intention is to make life so difficult for the other side that they weary of the exercise and are driven to settle. As both parties usually have teams of lawyers of the same kind, I don't think it often achieves its objective. But when reference is made in court to the 8th or 10th letter of a particular day between solicitors, you do really do begin to wonder where it's all going. It's too easy for solicitors with laptops or desktops to whack out yet another letter and send it electronically. There's a very well-intentioned desire in the United Kingdom that no one should be driven from the judgment seat by virtue of cost factors, inability to pay his own costs, the risk of having to pay the other side. But a blackmail system is surely not what we want. Lord Justice Jackson's solution to this is to put control of costs budgeting, cost management and cost recovery in the hands of those in the system who probably know least about it, namely the judges. It's a long time since he was a trial judge. So control of costs is now seen as a unitary exercise with giving directions. And at a case management hearing, the judge is now expected to set a limit on the amount of costs that any party can incur in relation to any particular given issue, witness statements, disclosure, or experts, as the case may be. And each party is expected to produce to the court a budget of what they expect to spend and to justify it. And the court will then approve it or disapprove it, as the case may be. The judge decides what is appropriate, gives directions, and sets the budget, beyond which the party is going to be unable to recover costs, absent some change of heart or mind on the part of the court. When the United States President Calvin Coolidge came home from church one Sunday morning, his wife asked him what the sermon had been about. What had the preacher said? What was it about? Sin, he replied. What did he have to say about it? She asked him. Oh, he was against it, he replied. And that's basically where I stand on cost management. But I've been overruled on the subject, and that's what's going to happen. But the effect of it in the context of commercial litigation, the key element to me is this, in the context of the trends which I've seen, is the extent to which the judge is going to become yet more inquisitorial and control the whole of the litigation, defining the case for the parties at an early point when setting a cost budget and a combination of directions. Judicial control will shape the way the case is being put. And with the tools at his disposal that the judge has, the judge will actually be in a position to determine which issues are worthy of being litigated because of the control of the costs that are going to be incurred, looking at factual evidence and expert evidence, because he will be approving or disapproving the costs in advance. I think that's a highly dangerous state of affairs. It may mean, of course, there'll be a hidden element of costs where parties take the risk that they won't recover costs at the end of the day and incur them just the same, and hope ultimately to persuade the judge that what they did was right. It seems to me the court can't stop a party from calling a witness unless that witness's evidence is so plainly irrelevant that it doesn't go to any issue at all. The judge may be able to limit the costs incurred or recoverable for the moment, but he can't stop the party having his say or calling evidence, and so it should be. I don't think judges are going to be much good in terms of cost control. No doubt, as I say, as a vibrant new body of judges comes through who've been involved with costs argument all the way up, they will get better and better at it. But do you really want the ambit of the dispute to be determined by the court rather than by the parties? Judges are only too capable of making mistakes, particularly at an early stage when the material in front of them is limited. Pleadings, a case memorandum that explains what the case is about, a list of issues, but none of the evidence. except that what's going to happen is the parties will put in evidence at this stage in order to justify the costs they hope to incur, and costs will become more front-loaded. Judges can make mistakes. There's the story of the Secretary General of the United Nations, the Archbishop of Canterbury, the top bishop in the Church of England, and a member of the Supreme Court in the United Kingdom, who are off on a justice mission trip to a remote part of Africa. We tend now to refer to the members of the Supreme Court, at least if you were brought up with pop music in the 1960s, as the Supremes. But at all events, these three are on a mission trip to a justice mission trip to a distant part of Africa. And they're flown to a remote spot in a small plane. As they're about to leave, a backpacking student wanders out of the jungle and cheekily asks the Archbishop of Canterbury if he can hitch a lift back on the plane to civilization. The Archbishop of Canterbury, being, as you would expect, a kind and gracious man, says yes, of course, and persuades the other members of the mission to agree. On they get into the small plane to fly back to civilization. And halfway back, the engine coughs, splutters, and fails. The pilot turns around to the passengers. "We have a problem," he says. "With this student, we have 5 persons on board and only 4 parachutes. I've got one, and I'm off." And without further ado, he opens the door and jumps out with the parachute. Whereupon the others start looking at each other. And the Secretary General of the United Nations launches into a short speech about how vital his role is in the world in the preservation of world peace, and how the prospects of such peace would be diminished were he not to survive, grabs one of the packs and jumps out. The member of the Supreme Court starts to address the others. They're pretty brief at this point, not a lot of time to go with. But he starts to say just how important he is, how he has incomparable expertise in the area of human rights in particular, and moreover, he is the cleverest man in the Western Hemisphere. And without further amplification, he grabs a pack and is gone through the door. The Archbishop of Canterbury turns and looks at the student. He clears his throat somewhat nervously, but is preempted by the student. "No worries, Archbish. The cleverest man in the Western Hemisphere just jumped out with my backpack." Judges can make mistakes. The memorandum of understanding about enforcement of judgments that Michael mentioned that we signed with the DIFC last year reflects the cooperation which ought to exist between international courts. All over the world, countries are seeking to set up their own commercial courts because the states in question see the operation of effective courts in the commercial arena with expertise in that area as creating business confidence and encouraging trade to the benefit of the local or national economy. And in consequence, courts are then being seen as being in competition one with the other for international litigation business. But whatever the impact on the revenue of the lawyers in those areas and the disputes resolution industry, as it undoubtedly is, with its knock-on effect on the local economy, the ultimate issue for the courts everywhere ought simply to be the doing of justice, nationally and internationally, and cooperation between them to achieve that end. So if there are lessons which can be learned from the experience or mistakes of another jurisdiction, that information should, in my view, be shared with a view to improving the administration of justice all round. and exchanges of information on occasions such as this may just help in that. I hope I've been in no way disloyal to the jurisdiction of which I'm inordinately fond, but I am grateful and privileged to have had the opportunity to talk to you today. I hope it's been of some interest and some assistance. But thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much indeed, Justice Sir Jeremy. And we're now at the stage of having questions and answers from the audience. So I'm not sure if you know this, but when Sir Jeremy was at university in Oxford, he played a lot of rugby. He was a double blue. He then went on to play for Harlequins, one of the premier rugby clubs in the United Kingdom. And I thought he tackled the issues of today's presentation extremely well. Does anyone have any questions they'd like to raise? Please raise your hand. There's a microphone which will come around.
Could I just take up the costs point and ask a question and make a comment? And the comment is, you mentioned that there are now these huge trials that take a couple of years to get to trial and that last 3 months. Isn't one of the answers to shorten the time that it takes for these cases to reach trial and to shorten the period available for the trial, which thereby forces people to compress the issues and go to the relevant issues, and to shorten the massive amount of submissions and pleadings and so on that are made? And in international arbitration, that is pretty much what is done, and much tighter timetables are sought to be imposed and kept. And I wonder what your thought would be about the ability to do that in the commercial court.
As a matter of theory, I agree. But in practical terms, it means getting to grips with the case early on and having a sufficient grasp to be confident as to what is an appropriate length of time in the face of what the advocates are telling you. And to a significant extent, one is very reliant upon the lawyers appearing in front of you in terms of what they're telling you the real issues are. Now, I could have told you that 46 pages of issues were unlikely to be all real issues. But for me to separate out at a time when I knew about less than a tenth, I would think, of what the parties knew would have been extremely hard. And when you get very large sums of money in issue, one's loath to do that for obvious reasons. If I'd been given 3 weeks to read the papers, that would have been a different thing. But life isn't like that. One just doesn't have that sort of time with the pressure of other work. If I get 2 days to read for a case management conference, I'm still pressed to read everything that I have to read for it. So, yes, I agree in theory, but in practice, it's very difficult. And one's plea is always to the advocates. Look, red face test. You know what the good points are. You know what the bad points are. Assume the judge is bright and is not going to fall for the bad points. All you're going to do is to derogate from your good points. And then you get the case where there are no good points. So they won all the bad points.
So not only is Michael Huang the Chief Justice of the DIFC Courts, but also is a very well-respected international arbitrator. Alec, you raised the point of arbitration. Chief Justice, in your experience between the courts and arbitration, how do they, if they do at all, handle active case management?
Well, the first difference is that in arbitration, you effectively have what in the courts would be called a docket system, meaning that from the very beginning, the final adjudicator of the dispute will be the one controlling the pace and the extent of the interlocutory steps to be taken. The second difference is that I'm not familiar with the current practice in the English commercial courts, but certainly in Singapore, when I was practicing, the pleadings in litigation are usually much shorter than the pleadings in international arbitration. That gap perhaps might be shrinking as more sophisticated lawyers have more complicated cases which require a bit of expansion in terms of their pleadings, but generally speaking, it's been drummed into advocates from a very early age that your pleadings have to be concise and succinct rather than expansionist. But this leads me to the point that in an arbitration, you tend to get initial pleadings of anywhere 50 pages and more, and it comes together with maybe one or even two archlever files of exhibits. So the material is there for the arbitrator from the very beginning to get familiar with the case. And in fact, as an arbitrator, I would encourage parties to do that, to do what I call front-loading the case, so that the arbitrator, who is on a docket system, understands as far as he can the issues in dispute, and therefore he can control the case management process much better. In litigation, sometimes the courts are prisoners of their own system, a counsel might get criticized for prolix pleading as opposed to a submission. But these days, I think these differences are probably narrowing. If a judge wants to get hold of a case, and of course, if he's told that that is his case, he's going to be the assigned judge for the case, he has an interest in getting to know the case and coming to grips with it early. And so, for example, I can't remember in the CPR whether you actually insist on them forming a list of issues, but in arbitration, we're all trained, you must have a list of issues, and you've got to try as far as you can to settle the list of issues. Now, it's true that counsel can disagree on formulation of issues, even if the difference is between 10 issues and 15 issues, they can come into deadlock. But I always take a sort of step back view and say, it really doesn't matter. You don't have to get parties to agree on the issues. The function of issues is actually for one party to inform, A, the other side, B, the tribunal, these are the things I'm going to be arguing about at the hearing, and I give you notice of that now. Now, unless at that stage the other side can say, no, that is completely off track, it cannot possibly affect the outcome of the case, that particular issue, the other side should say, thank you very much for letting me know. I will deal with it, you know, as I think fit. And you can say, that's a non-issue, and I will deal with it, you know, in three lines, and to demonstrate why it's a non-issue. But I don't try and make people agree on the issues. And if there are disputes, then each side will list out their own version of the issues. And that will then inform the tribunal in handling the document disclosures, the discovery issues in a much better way, because then when you have a dispute about discovery or disclosure, the tribunal will say, you want this document, tell me which of the issues does this document go towards addressing, and in what way is this document material to the outcome of the case. Remember, in the DIFC, we have adopted the IBA test rather than the test of general relevance, especially the abandonment of what the English lawyers will be familiar with, what we call the Peruvian guano principle, which is, you know, it's not directly relevant, but it leads you to a trail of inquiry whereby you might discover something relevant. We at the DIFC have taken a much more brutal approach and says, you've got to show right now how this line of inquiry you're pursuing is going to be determinative of the outcome of either the case as a whole or a material issue in the case. And that gives the court a much better stick to beat with in trimming down the amount of disclosure that comes out. It's probably enough for now, too.
I venture to suggest that it would have made not a scrap of difference in the case that I was involved in. It was extremely efficiently run by counsel. There were a lot of arguments that, on instructions of the client, they plainly had to run. Peruvian guano went out of the window long ago. Disclosure was limited to the principles that you're familiar with. The case was closely timetabled and we stuck to the schedule absolutely, with witnesses limited to time, chess time clock stuff. Mm. In truth, I don't think any tribunal hearing it could really have done anything very different. I'd seen cases of a similar kind which had overrun, where they'd set out on a 3-month trial and finished up with 6 months, and then the judge had taken almost another 6 months to write the judgment. There are some cases which are so large, and this is probably the largest claim ever brought in the commercial court in London, that in reality, in order to do justice, you've got to allow people to have their say. And much as one would like to cut down the costs, it's not possible. The costs on one side of this case were £66 million, and on the other side, £38.5 million. So you get some idea. The size of the claims made those pale into insignificance. That's the truth of it.
We said if the case is as complex as that, for the court to bite the bullet at the beginning and say this is too big a case for a single judge.
Well, I did have that thought when I was about halfway through it.
And that's why in international arbitration, anything but the smallest cases get three. I mean, that's for a different reason, because it's a one-stop shop. I mean, that's it. You get your one shot and the tribunal's decision is final on merits. But when you just get to the size of the kind of case that Sir Jeremy is talking about, then you start to realize that it really is beyond one person. I just think it is. It's not. It needs a little bit of rethinking and flexibility.
Very good, Sir David.
Can I express agreement with everything that Jeremy has said, because it's entirely accords with my own experience, both in London and here. Just two points I would like to make. First, to share his concern about the way in which and the scale of witness statements. They are prepared by a team of lawyers. They're prepared by a team of lawyers, and they are stuffed with argument, and they spell out in excessive detail the contents of documents which are actually annexed to the statement. But the point I wanted to add was that one of the difficulties about these enormous statements is that they impose an intolerable burden on the judge. If you have a case in which there are 10 witnesses for the claimant, and each of them have produced a witness statement 100 pages long, and you're going to have a succession of those witnesses coming along and give their evidence in chief by simply clumping the statement on the table, it means the judge has got to read the statements first. Now, speaking for myself, I often found myself in the position that I'd actually forgotten what the beginning of the witness statement when I got to the end of it. And even more so, if I had read all the statements before the trial started, and the first witness comes along, and I can't even remember who he is, let alone what he said. And that is, I think, another good reason to review our manner in which evidence in chief is given. Mm. I suspect if we gave evidence in chief orally in the response to non-leading questions in the what might be just called an old-fashioned way, it would be quicker and cheaper. The other point I wanted to make is in relation to the scale of skeleton arguments, which suffer from, in a sense, exactly the same problem, that they're so enormous that they impose an intolerable burden on the judge. But I must tell you how one chairman of an arbitration panel that I sat in dealt with this problem. A very distinguished arbiter, not as distinguished as the Chief Justice, but he made an order that knows the closing skeleton should not exceed 30 pages in length. When the claimant turned up with a 100-page document, he said, "Will you please hand that to your opponent?" Which he did. And then he said to his opponent, "You can tear out of that 70 pages at random, and I'll read what's left.
To answer Sir David's point about long witness statements and not being able to remember either what the statement says or who the witness was, particularly when you have a long list of witnesses, I have a model procedural order number one in all my arbitrations, and one of them deals with witness statements. And my directions for witness statements will say, your witness statement, if it exceeds 20 pages, will have at the beginning an executive summary of the rest of the statement, and secondly, you will attach a recent photograph of the witness. Because when 2 months or 3 months down the line, you're reading the statement, which witness was that?
Esam.
Good evening. I was interested to hear that there's a good number of cases settled through an alternative dispute resolution rather than going to the courts. There is one occasion where I see courts have the alternative disputes system within the courts, and most of the times, at least when I see it, is probably cosmetics rather than effective. Now, in your experience in settling these cases, was it an effective system that you actually could settle cases and there was enough investment in terms from the judges, from the clerk, from the court system, in investing in the process of dispute resolution system? And what's the key success for a good system and a bad system in your experience?
Well, within the commercial court system, the judge himself never gets involved in the alternative dispute resolution. There's a big industry now in the UK with organizations that provide mediators, and the parties go off to mediation. And often that will involve a full day, 2 days with the parties and their lawyers presenting their cases, and then the mediator trotting between one and the other to bring about a settlement, testing and probing the arguments and saying, well, a court's not going to buy that, is it? What do you really think? And as I say, over 85% of cases that get referred to mediation settle. And in all, over 90% essentially of cases that begin in the commercial court settle. But one of the things I often do in the commercial court, instead of ordering that the parties go to mediation, if I know I've got lawyers on each side who are sensible, well-informed, going to advise their clients about the merits, I simply provide that there will be a period of 2 weeks where the senior partner responsible for the litigation in each side will negotiate. Because the biggest barrier to negotiation is the loss of face in picking up the phone and saying, can we talk turkey? And if you remove that from the parties by the judge ordering that they will do it in a set period, I set a period of 2 weeks beginning on date X, you will negotiate and you'll report back to the court on success or failure. And very often that's just as effective as having a formal mediation without any of the cost. Because sensible parties, particularly commercial parties, in the end it's about money usually. They ought to be able to find a solution, and they do. So it's an intrinsic part of our process, but the court itself plays no part in the actual mediation itself. The judge is simply not involved, and other people are. In the end, it always comes down to how well lawyers are advising their clients and what notice the clients take of them, of course.
The IFC courts.
Experience in mediation.
And try and encourage settlements of the parties and get them into mediation?
We actually haven't conferred among the judges, you know, to poll how many of them do actually recommend mediation. Well, we don't have a policy on this. And so it's entirely up to the discretion of the judge. Now, given that the judges come only once a month, you know, and if a trial is fixed, it may not go down well with the parties if the judge on day one says, I think this case ought to be settled, why don't you guys go off and mediate and I'll see you in 3 months' time or something like that. If you want to do that kind of thing, that's why the docket system enables a judge or even a judicial officer who has read the papers early on to say, this case is crying out for a settlement, and the consequences of a successful lawsuit will be much worse than a negotiated settlement for both sides. Then there can be a suspension of proceedings in dealing with interlocutory steps. For example, you don't fix the date for trial, allow a decent period for mediation to take place, and then if it doesn't succeed, then bring it back for fixing. But if the judge on day one says, I think this is a case that ought to be settled, then there might be a feeling that the judge is just being lazy, or he doesn't want to do the work, or he hasn't read the papers. The party, I mean, leaving aside the lawyers, the parties themselves may not be so happy. But in theory, yes, we have had cases in my other jurisdiction in Singapore, where in the middle of a case, very often the judge says, I just think that this is getting out of hand, it's getting disproportionate, why don't parties try and settle? But usually those are in the context of either cases where there is a sort of relationship between the parties, not an isolated contract, but it's a joint venture, it's a long-term distributorship agreement, where there has been some commercial relationship built over a period of time and which might possibly extend for the future, and they have a disagreement about something. And then you say, well, there is a hope here because that's sort of fertile ground for a skillful mediator to navigate through and try and find positives for the parties to seize on as an alternative to fighting their dispute to the bitter end. So you have to identify some family disputes is another kind of a case where typically judges will recommend that they try and mediate. Of course, joint ventures which fail. But where the cases, the parties are saying, well, it was just a terrible experience and there's no way we can get back together again, and all we want to know is who's right and who's wrong. It's a bit difficult to suggest, but I think by and large, I think actually all of the judges here would agree that where there is any kind of realistic prospect that there might be a negotiated settlement, the court would be sympathetic to certainly a request from the parties to say, we are actually negotiating, will you give us time to negotiate? I think within constraints, because the consequences are for the parties to appreciate and to take into account when they opt for either postponing a trial or breaking off a trial halfway. So there's nothing different in principle with the way I think judges in the DIFC would approach the question of mediation, but it's really a question of, I think, identifying which cases are suitable for mediation. I mean, for example, in Singapore, we have a system whereby there is compulsory court-assisted mediation. But that only applies at the level below the CFI. In other words, for the equivalent of small claims tribunals in Singapore, no case can get to a trial without first going through a mediation process if they fall within certain categories. And these are the categories where experience has shown that 95% of these cases, if they ever came to trial, will settle on the first day. Accident cases, running down cases, employment cases, landlord and tenant cases, money lending cases. So those are cases which they have to go through a mediation process by a judge, and the judge tries to settle it. If he can't, then another judge will hear the case, rather like our SCT system. So it's just that our SCT system elevated to a slightly higher level.
Well, let's pursue this, if I may, for a while, because the systems are coming at it differently. In the commercial court, you say, as a matter of practice, into the orders goes a requirement for the parties to at least negotiate. You're willing to order that the senior partners involved should go away and spend 2 weeks doing it. In the DIFC courts, it's more passive. It's a question in the case management information sheet. In all of the cases that I've seen in the courts and the tribunal bar one, the parties have said, we've discussed alternative dispute resolution and we don't think it's going to be helpful. So I suppose I throw it out to the audience. Which is the preferred approach for the court to mandate that the parties go away and consider some form of mediation, or to leave it to the parties at case management to determine if it's the right course? Who'd like to have a go at that? Fiona.
Position that the court should be able to direct and mandate a mediation in circumstances where the parties are well advised in commercial matters. I accept that in the lower, if you like, the domestic consumer type environments, the small claims tribunal in the context of this court, that that's an appropriate mechanism that is in effect written into the rules, that there is a compulsory mediation or conciliation process before one gets access to the adjudicatory power of the court. But in a court of this nature, which is a commercial court, where the parties are routinely represented by competent and experienced commercial counsel, and the parties themselves are almost invariably competent and commercial negotiators, it is with respect somewhat impudent of the court to suggest that their own efforts to conciliate and mediate outside the parameters of the court should yet be further explored. These are commercial parties, they do deals all the time. The court is probably their last resort and not their first resort, and except in circumstances where it is the parties are indicating a preparedness to conciliate by justice by reconciliation or mediate, and indicate that they need the auspices of the court to sort of frame how they might come together in those circumstances and seek the assistance of the court, it should not be open to the court to mandate it, notwithstanding the party's opposition or objection to that process.
Thank you. We do have a number of accredited mediators in the room. Does anybody take a different view that they'd like to put forward? Does anybody believe the court should be much more active in encouraging, almost forcing the parties to mediation? Yes.
All I was going to say is that there may be a halfway approach, which is for the court in its case management information sheet to ask the parties to explain why they don't think the mediation process is going to work in the context of this particular case.
Yeah. That is in practice what goes on. I will never force parties to mediate. If both counsel say to me, we fully considered this, there's a point of principle at issue here that needs to be decided, it's a yes or no answer, of course, no court is going to force people to mediate, and indeed, of course, you can't force people to negotiate. What you can do, however, is encourage them. And any litigator knows, and any judge knows, that blood all over the floor is less good than a deal done, a compromise. And so I do regard it as part of my function to encourage people to do that. But at the end of the day, I entirely take your point. One can't force people into mediation who don't want to go. But if you're given that encouragement, the vast majority of people do go, and the success rate is such that one knows it's usually worthwhile.
Mark, there's many cases. I mean, people go to courts not only for justice, for tactics, and that's granted. But there is cases where it's a fact that both party in the case knows that they end up losers. I.e., if they are a partner in a big joint venture, there is a huge dispute, and it's like a classic divorce where people are going to throw dishes at each other, and eventually the company is going to basically come to the grounds on both. And that's occasion where the tension high between the party, and unfortunately lawyers tend to inherit that tension in their process. So they basically get sides and having a neutral party just to open the window is not a bad idea.
I think this gets back to Sir Jeremy's point about not agreed that you don't force them, but where I think it largely depends on a multitude of factors. One is the experience of the judge himself or herself, and the other is, again, the experience of the counsel involved. You have to understand the dynamics of dispute resolution and to know how scenarios that are in the case that is before you usually play out. I mean, you just, this is not going to be in the books. This you have to learn on the job. And so it needs certain a certain age, certain maturity, and certain experience to be able to identify the cases where the court can realistically say, I think this is a case that there is a possibility. And sometimes the complexity of the case itself can throw the parties into a scenario where they would be more amenable to enter into mediation, precisely for the reason that Sir Jeremy identified, that two experienced counsel but with very high-strung clients, and they neither of them wants to be the first one to tell their client, why don't we negotiate? And the guy says, well, you know, are you not confident in my case? Are you sure that you've advised me correctly? And so on. But once the judge says, you know, I'm looking at the arguments, I'm looking at the papers, and I think for a number of reasons, you people should explore the possibility of a negotiated or mediated settlement, then both parties have then said, well, you know, it's not us that told you, it's the judge. And obviously he's not certain which way he's going to decide. And then that's when the client says, oh, if he's not sure, then, you know, it's not a sure thing either way, so let's go and, you know, see whether we can work out a better alternative.
Any questions? Sorry. Any questions on this ADR point before perhaps we might move on to the question of cost? Because if I've understood you, Sir Jeremy, you're a big fan of the Jackson reforms. I think I've got that right. And but if you were to have to tweak them in any way, how might you achieve your goal of getting back to a situation where costs perhaps were more manageable, more understandable, and more satisfactory from a client point of view? What adjustments would you make, or would you start from scratch, and how would you deal with it?
I think this is exactly where what we were hearing about parties being well advised really matters. I think it's very difficult for a judge to control the costs in any sensible manner before the case is actually heard. At the end of the day, we have a system of cost judges who will control the ultimate recoverability based on what has actually taken place. But to do it in advance, I think, in complex commercial disputes is madness. I'm probably being quoted all around the world, heard around the world. I've made no secret of this in my submissions to those responsible for bringing in the system. The real key is lawyers advising their clients as to what are realistic arguments to run and what aren't. And if parties would be robust about that, and my constant theme has been to say to parties, get a leading advocate in very early on, get him to advise on which points work and which points don't, go with his judgment and run those points which he says are workable and abandon those which aren't. And then you would have costs kept within a reasonable framework. Keep in mind what is the origin of the dispute, because usually most commercial relationships founder on one main issue. And that's the real issue. And lawyers often create lots of additional arguments that are really nothing to the point so far as the clients are concerned. And keeping things simple is ultimately the best form of advocacy. We all know that most cases turn on one, two, or just possibly three points. The rest is for the birds, isn't it? And the sooner people recognize that and advise their clients appropriately, the better off they'll be, and the more client satisfaction there will be that a case is being run for the right reasons, on the right lines, without the lawyers obfuscating the issues and making themselves a lot of money by churning in the process. So that's the robust view, and that's where I'd like us to go.
Chief Justice?
I don't think I've had anything to add on that particular point.
To the churners in the room, any questions?
Many of our fellow practitioners here are equally horrified. I happily left the jurisdiction before. Sorry? before I happily left England before those reforms were initiated. Just please don't introduce them here. But I do ask if the judges are facilitated or trained on the question of costs, because with due respect to your brethren and sisterhood, I hope, when was the last time, if ever, you had practiced in circumstances where the costs of an undertaking, quoting to clients, estimating the effort of the undertaking and so on, was familiar to you? I hazard to guess that for the barristers who make it to the High Court, they've never had to do it. And although we see an increasing number of solicitors who have been successful partners of big commercial law firms who may be more familiar with the process and running a business, I would suggest that by the time they get to hear these complex cases, they have long since forgotten what the true cost of the undertaking really is.
Well, you may have noticed that during my talk I said those least able probably to form a judgment on the question of those being given the power to do so. And I absolutely take your point. We do have limited experience in terms of summary assessment of costs, so that on a daily basis I'm assessing costs of £100,000 or less, but it's a very broad brush approach. We also do have courses upon which we go where costs are raised, but it will now have to be a very significant element in judicial training. And indeed the Commercial Court is about to bring in the cost judges to give us some training on the subject. But as I indicated to you at the outset when I was talking from the rostrum, most commercials, as the citizens get used to doing it too, a group of where judges actually to being better equipped to be very wrong.
So Jeremy, taxing my access, tax access of by
judges, so access to a huge amount of money. They do the top of the by the seat.
I mean, in what we do. And was the case, the dispute, how many documents, how many the tax, there isn't that way. And so, what to the degree of cost.
Only 10% of file ever taxation. That's just interesting. It's a tiny don't trust the cost. In fact, the usual thing by which the end of a term is in the order of the percentage a little bit more because I'm very for them to settle. They're able to do that. Actually, they're very well context because is. But really is the product as to how it if the issue less.
Excellent. End of the could we think just
certainly just give issue. Excellent. Thank you much. I'd also like to thank Mac. This issue has been. I'd like to thank the courts for their support and the commercial court. Most welcome. I'd like to thank the courts who have helped Owen and his Dubai courts, Roger from the DIFC Courts. Thank all your efforts, everybody else involved. Doctors for taking and back and this lecture. And if we the record available subsequently. So I suppose that's we'll have to thank Chief Justice and the Cook along with the DIFC Courts. Most of all for this evening.